One day, a talented lasso fellow, a special one with face of yellow, will make the piece of resistance found from its hiding refuge underground. And with a noble army at the helm, this master builder will thwart the Kraggle and save the realm and be the greatest, most interesting, most important person of all times. All this is true because it rhymes.
Tell Crazy someplace else. We're all stocked up here.
The wizard says go away!
These things must be done delicately.
I'll have to give the matter a little thought.
No matter what anybody tells you, words and ideas can change the world.
But I tried, didn't I? God damn it. At least I did that.
Time is a precious thing. Never waste it.
Inside this room, all of my dreams become realities, and some of my realities become dreams.
We are the music makers, and we are the dreamers of dreams.
Purposeful repurposing. Does repurposing mean that the original intended purpose is negated by the new purpose? Can both simultaneously exist without damaging the function of the other? Ask anyone who's ever used their pocket knife as a screwdriver. They'll tell you a pocket knife can be many useful tools. Now strike that. Reverse it. In the words of Ani DeFranco, any tool can be a weapon if you hold it right. Be careful with that. If something as simple as a pocket knife can wield such diversity, what diverse possibilities can we imagine for the uses for a few numbers, some simple shapes? What type of design element is being used? Line, form, dot, etc. What does each aspect of the symbol represent? Are there multiple things that could be applied to said symbol? How many functions can one tool possess? Okay, these are the basics. It is now our job to translate these symbols, and we're trying to read them like we'd read our own terrible handwriting. Chicken scratch. Illegible scribblings. Is that what this is? Chicken scratch? Why bother? Ogham, pronounced Ogham, is the earliest form of known writing in the Irish language. Ogham is thought to have originated in the 4th century AD and was used widely until the 7th century AD. Originally, this alphabet consisted of 20 characters, Fews, Fees, Feada, associated with consonant and simple vowel sounds. Later, 5 more characters were added to include complex vowel sounds as well. Often found carved into the corners of stones, these characters are strokes carved across a vertical line, read vertically from the bottom to the top. It is believed the Ogham language was used in the Irish and Pictish lands and from the people of what is now Scotland and Ireland before the 4th century, but was carved into perishable items, such as wood, those items being lost to decay in time. The word Ogham is said to come from the term Ogham, which means Old Irish, and translates into English as point seam. This metamorphic compound word expression, a kenning, was common in Old Norse and Old English poetry. Battle metal might be used instead of weapons, or steed may refer to a boat. That said, point seam is an intriguing translation, as we will later see. Ogham actually refers to the forms of the letters. The true name of the alphabet is Beth Lewis Nguyen, which many have noted sounds an awful lot like Bethlehem. Ogham was used throughout the British Isles by various Celtic people before being replaced by Latin in the early 7th century. What could it possibly mean? It just looks like a bunch of hash marks, lines, simplistic, primitive. Can't be that complicated, right? Each letter, or few, has several attributes represented in this seemingly simple form. Each is an alphabetic letter with a sound association, a numerical digit, a calendar month dictated by lunar cycles, a tree, a specific word, a divinatory meaning, and more. Most inscriptions are found as the names of people or markers for family lands or dwellings, and sometimes just to mark the path taken by certain groups like we might do now. Stargazer was here.
Chai must truly be a great realm, Master Kenji. My governors are held in high honor.
When looking over the Perat paper, characteristics for the occurrence of a high current Z-pinch aurora as recorded by antiquity, figure 27 stuck out. The conceptual geometry and experimental laser shadow graph of an intense current conducting toroidal stack? I couldn't help but notice how much it resembled a vertical sentence in Ogham. The paper compares the toroidal stacks with petroglyphs of ladder forms from all over the world. His most intriguing correlation. There's these ladder formations, the toroidal stacks, and the ohms. They all have a curl at the edge of the flattened toroids, just as Pratt describes. The same curls are used to begin and end sentences in the ohm. In the ohm, they're called feathers. Ayeta to open the sentence, Ayeta to thawal to close a sentence. Perhaps the most important feature, explains Parad, depicted in the petroglyph shown in figure 27, is the curling of the edges of the flattened toroids. This feature is exact enough so that a time motion representation of the curling may be made directly to compare its experimental counterpart. The curling, or folding, progression, thus provides time information when the petroglyphs are scaled to laboratory data.
Data, data, data. I cannot make bricks without clay.
In vortices with increasing current, the tips of the ladder rungs begin to curl and form a vortex. Yet, a stronger current, the toroids themselves roll up, as shown in figure 28. Figure 28 provides the first direct evidence of the exactness to which the petroglyphs were carved, in spite of cultural influences and interpretation. Pratt continues. The ladder rungs stacked medium current toroids are shown to fold and bend as they do in laboratory photographs. Subtle changes in the petroglyphs corresponding to the plasma instability morphologies have been reproduced with precise accuracy, even including in proper order the admixture of toroid types. I would postulate here that the Ogham Fews might be a symbolic diagram of these increasing currents and the behavior that might be expected in proper order, including the mixture of toroid types. Maybe. We might even be able to assign names to the parts of their function, such as been done with these old Negev petroglyphs.
Handbook for the recently diseased.
Deceased. Well, why did you disappear when you stepped off the porch? Are we halfway to heaven? Are we halfway to hell? And how long is this going to last?
Well, I don't see anything about heaven or hell. This book reads like stereo instructions. Listen to this. Geographical and temporal perimeters. Functional perimeters vary from manifestation to manifestation.
The Book of Ballymote is a handwritten Irish text that dates back to 1391 AD. The wikis say, the book is a compilation of older works, mostly loose manuscripts and valuable documents handed down from antiquity. The very first page of the Book of Ballymote is the story of Noah and the Flood. I think this can be seen as a major clue as to the reasons behind the contents of the book. Maybe it contains information for foreseeing such an event. We'll have to get to that.
We have sort of a problem here.
Yeah, you apparently didn't put one of the new cover sheets on your TPS reports.
Among other historical and maybe mythical contents is a list of over 100 scales or forms of Ogham, the Ogham tract, which every student of Irish poetry was required to learn, and three windows, which are the entire collection of Ogham depicted as concentric circles with hash marks, concentric squares with hash marks, and a quartered circle with numerous groupings of crescent moon shapes, and at the very bottom, an assortment of strange symbols that are not included as letters of the alphabet, nor are they adequately defined or described in any way. Peculiar indeed. You can find an extensive list of the varying forms of Ogham in their sometimes hilarious breakdowns linked below. My favorite assumptive definition is for track number 35, Ogham of Uproar and Anger, in which it is said the name comes from the frustration of anyone trying to make sense of anything written in it. I feel their pain. I can't imagine actually having to use this alphabet as an effective form of clear communication. It's a great reason to look at them differently.
Just relax and let your mind go blank. It shouldn't be hard for you.
In his book titled Principles of Lightning Physics, Vladislav Major, PhD, a researcher at the National Severe Storms Laboratory for the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration, explains how natural spark discharges occurring in nature can be reproduced for study in the lab. Mazur starts by quoting Bazelin and Razor from 1998 by saying, "Lightning is, in and of itself, a tremendous spark discharge, and lightning is justly believed to be the longest spark discharge observable. In electrical discharge in air, lightning shares many common features with spark discharges produced in gap in high voltage laboratory. There, electrical breakdown is achieved by applying high voltage in a gap of up to several meters between two electrodes, usually one pointed and one flat." One pointed and one flat. You don't say. What else does Mazur have to say? What exactly is a plasma channel anyway? The presence of free electrons in plasma make the plasma capable of carrying electric current, which is directed motion of charged particles, electrons and ions, under the force of an electric field. The collisions between electrons and ions produce heat. The heating of the plasma produces an additional thermal ionization, which also makes the plasma luminous and visible. Other manifestations of lightning process, such as luminosity, acoustic waves from thunder, and electric and magnetic fields, are all the results of the flow of electric current through a lightning plasma channel. In addition to spark, other examples of plasma produced by electrical ionizations are neon and fluorescent lights and welding arcs, among others. Directed motion of charged particles under force of an electric field. Gotcha. When the action of an electric or electromagnetic field is applied, a strong ionized state occurs. This act is called electrical breakdown. The electrical breakdown of a gas is a spark and is similar to arc plasma. Electrical breakdown can happen in many types of conductive materials. When a pointed electrode of one polarity is connected to a high voltage generator and the flat electrode is connected to a grounded plate, a coronal glow can be produced. These do not resemble sparks. If the high voltage is applied slowly to the pointed tip, electrical breakdown can be exceeded and the tip will become ionized, causing a glowing cone to fan out, coronal discharge. In the pointed, positive electrode, electrons move toward the electrode. Positive ions move toward the tip, constituting a positive space charge. These coronal discharges are cold, but the current in corona may still remain luminous for several seconds. If the space charge is moved away from the electrode by wind, etc., the electric field is still present and the corona reappears. Look at all the pretty layers. This type of self-organization of plasma is known as the Debye screen effect. The effect occurs in the ionosphere, in radio frequency discharges, and in plasma. For it to take effect, there has to be a large number of charged particles. Plasma interactions with the average electric field are dominated when they exceed the greater screen length, causing behavioral differences in the plasma due to the collective particle motions. The motion of electrons in the electrostatic field restore charge neutrality when originating from the perturbation of charge neutrality. Since electrons have a larger mobility than ions, they begin to oscillate nearly around the equilibrium positions, corresponding to the neutrality situation, with a characteristic angular frequency called plasma frequency.
This, anyone know what this is? Class, anyone? Anyone? Anyone seen this before? The Laffer curve. Anyone know what this says? It says that at this point on the revenue curve, you will get exactly the same amount of revenue as at this point.
I'm sorry, but all questions must be submitted in writing.
In 2015, Cornell University published a paper titled Real-Time Imaging of Density Ducts. The plasma sphere is described as being embedded with cylindrical density ducts that are strongly aligned to Earth's magnetic field lines. Researchers noticed that the ducts were strikingly organized, regularly spaced, and were comprised of alternating tubes of over-densities and under-densities. The alternating densities are described in the counter-rotating currents of Don Scott's Birkeland current model as well. Let's say that each layer is a layer of the field in the Acme families of the Ogham. If these concentric circles represent the coronal glow emanating off a point, then each circle could possibly represent the density of layers of Fionn's window. Maybe each letter is a representative of the layer of density and the behavior of the charge. Coronal discharges are common during thunderstorms and can be measured emanating from objects with pointed shapes, such as trees or even blades of grass. The magnitude of the electric field is increased by the sharp edges of the pointed structures. Major says, most of the ground vegetation affected by the strong electric field under a thunderstorm produces coronas, but they usually remain invisible due to their low luminosity. Space charges from the ground vegetation create a charge layer above the ground that may be as thick as a few hundred meters. This charge layer significantly diminishes the ambient electric field near the ground. That Major, he's one smart guy. Remember the word Ogham is said to come from the term Ogham, which translates into English as point seam. In fact, one of the most common artifacts found throughout the region are bronze and gold pins. This insinuation is not to negate the practical function applied to these pins by archaeologists as clothing fasteners, but rather, again, to imply a multi-purpose function of many of the objects found at the ancient sites, and to say that if the ancients were concentrating atmospheric energy in some way, they weren't for lack of pins to do it. Point seam seems a little more poignant now. If, in our present electrical environment, vegetation can produce coronal discharges and the pointed natural objects like trees magnify the magnitude of electric fields, could you imagine the way vegetation may have lit up during a large thunder or solar storm in an increased electrical environment as proposed during this age of antiquity? It would have been a powerful sight, to say the least.
There it is! On the ceiling!
That's the one that got me. There's something very important I forgot to tell you.
What?
Don't cross the streams.
Why?
It would be bad.
I'm fuzzy on the whole good-bad thing. What do you mean bad?
Try to imagine all life as you know it stopping instantaneously and every molecule in your body exploding at the speed of light.
Total protonic reversal.
Right, that's bad.
So, we may have figured out the points. Now, how about those seams? For that, we'll have to talk about another type of coronal discharge, coronal streamers. While the coronal glow was produced by applying a high voltage slowly to the pointed electrode, applying high voltage and quick impulses form streamers. Instead of a glow, a thin coronal filament comes out of the electrode for a fraction of a millisecond. Streamers are a type of spark. Streamers always have two common features, a common stem at the high voltage electrode and that they are not continuous in space or time. They are much longer than the coronal glow cones, by up to several meters in the laboratory. But, like the coronal glow, the streamers are cold plasma with low conductivity. They carry a small current that is measured in microamperes. Streamers can cross a larger or smaller portion of the space gap, sometimes reaching the opposite electrode depending on the voltage. But, because of low conductivity, they will never cause a gap breakdown. Charge space is the same polarity as the starting electrode in a coronal stream region. The critical value of the electric field ahead of the streamers determines their length. Higher voltage is applied to produce more streamers. You know, Major had something interesting to say about this too. He says, we may experience a coronal streamer ourselves if we walk on a carpeted floor in a heated room during the winter, wearing shoes with leather soles. Through the friction between the carpet and our shoes, we are charging our bodies to a voltage of tens of kilovolts. Then, at the instant we touch a metal doorknob with our hand, we may experience a spark between our fingers and the knob. This spark is a corona streamer. Another example of corona streamers in nature is known as St. Elmo's fire, which emanates from sharp or pointed objects on tall buildings or ships during thunderstorms. St. Elmo's fire, point streamers, never cross the streams. Okay, guys, if at any point in the rest of this video the Stay Puft Marshmallow Man appears and wants to dance, you know what to do. All right, who wants to play a game of Follow the Leaders? The leader process is the transition of coronal streamers to a short hot plasma stem called a leader. It has been thought that all streamers would flow in a direction from the positive charge, causing a positive leader that starts at the anode and flows down to the cathode. It is the development of a downward pathway in the cloud that moves from a positive charge at the top of the cloud to the negative charge in the middle of the cloud. If the charge makes it all the way to the anode, from the anode to the cathode, or all the way to the ground, it's called flashover. Recently, it has been confirmed that negative lightning leaders are also a real occurrence in which the transition of the streamers in the negative leader process move upwards. In this case, the leader begins in the thundercloud and is released up into the atmosphere, releasing lightning up into the air. Both types of breakdown occur at 1/5 the speed of light and can trigger lightning. This bidirectional breakdown is more common than previously thought. It is known that these narrow bipolar events almost always occur in isolation or at the beginning of lightning flashes and are the most powerful natural emitter of very high frequency radio waves. Spherics are radio waves produced by lightning. If you've ever listened to an AM radio, you've probably heard them. Spherics can be produced from any power tool or motorized appliance and picked up by an AM receiver. Even the discharge from a spark plug in your car can produce a spheric that can be picked up by your car radio. That being said, any radio can be tuned into a lightning detector. Simply by tuning into a station with no or a very weak reception signal, and listen for a sudden sound, loud cracking noises, those are sphericks. The more muffled and smoother the cracking, the further away the lightning is. The louder and more distinct the popping, the closer the discharge.
You know, I think the storm's going to pass us.
How do you know?
Because I can count. You know what you do? When you see the lightning, you count until you hear the thunder. If you can count higher each time, that means the storm's moving away from us. Want to try it? Okay. Get some light. Wave's coming.
Wow.
Okay. Okay. One.
Two, three.
Okay, but I bet you next time you're going to be able to count to at least 4 or 5. Bet you.
Daddy, it's for you.
Now you tell him to take a message, sweet pea.
Since the spherics occur simultaneously to the lightning, you can accurately gauge if the lightning is coming towards you or moving away. And an AM radio can pick up these waves hundreds of miles away. It is also to be noted that the radios are especially receptive to spherics at night. That's super interesting.
I do believe we can make this work to our advantage.
I think I got it, but just in case, tell me the whole thing again. I wasn't listening.
Radio waves from lightning whistlers. Have you guys ever heard the Aurora Chorus? Did you watch the last video? Do you guys think the ancients were jamming out to their favorite tunes on the radio? Is that what this is about? It's kind of funny if you think about it. Rock on, ancients. But I'm not sure that that's exactly what they were doing.
We are being hailed, sir.
But who knows? The very, very simplest explanation that comes to mind is storm detection. Could they possibly have been storm tracking way back in the day? It might actually be something to consider. The first page of the Book of Ballymote is the story of Noah's Ark. There might be some more complicated explanations to consider as well. Okay, so we have a structure, we have some layers, we have pointy things to concentrate a plasmasphere. We've got some visual and audio representations. We got some know-how. Maybe we can use all this to know how the ancients were utilizing their resources. How do we decipher the Ogham and see what they're trying to tell us under this new electrified context? Let's go back to plasmoids real quick.
Okay, good luck with the slow descent into madness.
There is a notable progression in the flow of the 17 lines of Ogham in the Book of Ballymote. There are also variations in the curls at the beginning of each line. Some of the curls spiral inward toward the line of text. Some spiral outward, away from the line of text. This gives the feeling of directional flow. The letters stack in a sequence from 1 to 5 before changing how they sit on or with the line. The toroidal plasma stacks can be described in a very similar way. If we can envision these lines of Ogham as charts for plasma instability morphologies, then maybe we can see many significant patterns. The following explanation of plasmoids by the renowned plasma physicist William H. Bostick, we might get some insight by replacing the word plasmoid with the word Ogham. Ogham appears to be plasma cylinders elongated in the direction of the magnetic field. Ohms possess a measurable magnetic moment, a measurable transitional speed, a transverse electric field, and a measurable size. Ohms interact with each other, seemingly by reflecting off one another. Their orbits can be made to curve toward one another. Now, plasmoids can be made to spiral to a stop if projected into a gas. In the case of Ohms, we have to see about this one. Plasmoids can be made to smash each other into fragments. Again, it sure seems like this applies to Ogham, but I'd like to look deeper into it. There is some scant evidence at the time this quote was stated to support the hypothesis that they undergo fission and possess spin. Each Acme family of the Ogham consists of 1 to 5 directional lines crossing a vertical main stem. The main stem could be viewed as plasma cylinders. The intersecting lines could be traversing the magnetic field. The number of intersecting lines could be a measurable speed and size. Where the charge graduates from one letter of the Acme to the next could be their magnetic moment, and the direction of the lines might be indicative of the behavior of each set of Acme. Just go with me on this for a minute.
That is literally the dumbest thing I've ever heard.
Please, Wildstyle, let me handle this. That idea is just the worst.
Today, we might see them like this. This is the orbital angular momentum of a Gaussian beam at a different phase intensities. It makes me wonder, are there pieces missing? Is there something we've missed? Maybe discarded for lack of recognition? We've described radio frequency audio waves and other frequencies of EMF being captured and possibly converted into desired frequency ranges. We're going to need a few more things for that to happen. Things that could be very easy to dismiss. What if they were so fragile they didn't survive? What if they did survive, but we only saw them as rocks, pebbles on the ground? Jewelry, perhaps? It might be conceivable to imagine the light being projected through some sort of clear crystal to amplify and regulate it. Audio amplifiers convert audio waves. Optical resonators are a thing, too. They allow light to travel in circulation within a closed path through an arrangement of optical components. There are two main types of optical resonators, linear and ring. Linear resonators have two end mirrors that the light is bounced back and forth between, circulating continuously and counterpropagating waves that form standing wave patterns in their interference with one another. Ring resonators don't have end mirrors, so the light can circulate in two different directions, creating two light beams. They can be made with bulk optical components or waveguide resonators. Waveguides guide the light and are often a component of a bulk optical component resonator. In either case, the light is passed through each element of the resonator every time it is circulated through. I know it seems like we've gotten a little off track. But, like the light in our resonators, we are recirculating back around to the Ogham tract. Can they be used as light recipes? Are they telling us when and how the polarization of the wavelengths are changed so that the plasma generator can be used and conducted and maybe even the specific places that those charge frequencies are prevalent? Are the Ogham stones really radio station markers of some kind? Are they magic markers for the direction of light? Every trek that the light boldly takes around the resonator is subjecting it to alterations in its physicality due to the various effects in which the spatial distribution is changed. These journeys can cause the light to be diffracted or affect its focusing or unfocusing. To regulate all of these factors, sometimes wave plates made out of different biorefrigerant materials are employed. The wave plate is a crystalline plate or multiple parallel plates that shift the phase of polarized light. They can transform the state of polarization from horizontal to vertical, circular to linear, etc. A wave plate is a multi-purposed element that can perform as a filter, a switch, a tuner, or a valve. They are used to separate or combine wavelengths in a laser and help dampen down destructive feedback. An interesting side note is that these kinds of laser technologies are sometimes used in industrial laser cutting to enhance the uniformity and cleanliness of cuts by implementing a circular polarization of light. Wouldn't it be weird if this is how they carved all the spirals, the curbstones, the lozenges? Maybe. What is a laser but a linear-directed monochromatic plasmoid? Would an Ogham spell as sweet if called by any other name? Are the Ogham's diagrams for the angular orbital momentum shifts within the directed Gaussian beam? Wait a minute here. Did the ancients have lasers?
What is it? Your father's lightsaber. This is the weapon of a Jedi Knight. Not as clumsy or random as a blaster. An elegant weapon for a more civilized age. For over 1,000 generations, the Jedi Knights were the guardians of peace and justice in the Old Republic. Before the Dark Times. Before the Empire.
Bogus!
Ekme Beth has lines pointed to the right. This could insinuate right-hand spin rule, a clockwise motion, which predicts the behavior of a positive magnetic charge. In Ekme Huatha, the lines point to the left, counterclockwise, negative magnetic charge. Maybe. Ekme Mwen has diagonal lines, implying a directional movement upward, oblique, building. Ekme Eme has lines crossing in a perpendicular fashion to the stem. This is the family that most resembles Brot's ladder plasmoids and can be found throughout petroglyphs in the ancient world. The forfeita is where it starts to get really interesting. The forfeita, which means extra letters, were an addendum to the original alphabet. The letters were added later. I must say, this development could indicate an evolution in the understanding of the fields at play. The first letter code, the grove, is where all of the lines meet in the center of the Druidic eightfold calendar. This is the center of which the whole year revolves around. It is considered a divine pattern. And I have to say, it does resemble the cross-section of the interstellar medium, the intergalactic plane, and the solar system plane. It looks just like the astrological symbol for a sextile, which is basically 60 degrees apart. And when viewed as a plasma action, it looks like inverted symmetry, two equal angles pointed inward towards the stem, pointing at each other. Could it be pressure reflecting inward? And code also strongly resembles diagrammed actions for magnetic reconnection. The next letter, wire, gold, the spindle, looks like symmetrical reflection outward. Gold is extremely reflective. In the context of an electrical conductor, I don't think you could ask for a better raw material. Since it's a noble metal, it would send or reflect any charge back exactly how it was received. The wikis say, in machine tools, a spindle is a rotating axis of the machine, often which has a shaft at its heart. I think that's a good description for what we're seeing with this symbol, and it looks almost exactly like the symbol for filter or breather used in modern hydraulic systems. Yulian has this amazing 90-degree elbow, which turns itself in a spiral in an angular fashion. You can even listen to the music of an Irish Yulian instrument that's still being played today with one's elbow.
Never had one lesson.
We're going to talk about Ifin a little bit more in just a second. Next, we have more. The sea is probably the most important in understanding the entirety of the fields in which the Ogham are floating. More is considered to be the twin of the fourth view of the Ekme Hualatha. Coal, hazel, the letter C. More is Witch Hazel, the letter X. I can't help but see the C as the lattice matrix in which the electromagnetism functions. When it comes down to it, every bit of everything is basically light and sound refracted through a lattice. Would that be plaid? It's a crystalline epitaxy. It's the role structure plays. Sacred geometry seems to be a map to the substrate layers. Substrates capture the frequency of matter, and its distribution on the lattice determines the state. The substrate structures change the elemental structures. It is malleable. It folds. It bends. It is a woven tapestry of refracted light. It is everything. If the structure of the lattice in which the particles are trapped changes, so do the properties of the elemental structure. Perrott says, nearly all matter of the universe exists in a plasma state, occurring predominantly in this form in the sun and stars and interstellar space. Auroras, lightnings, and welding arcs are also plasma. Plasmas exist in neon and fluorescent tubes and in the sea of electrons that moves freely within the energy bands and the crystalline structure of metallic solids and in other objects. Plasmas are prodigious producers of electromagnetic radiation. In solid metals, the electrons that carry the electric current exist in a plasma within a more rigid crystalline structure.
Cause and effect, my love.
Waves create a topography, intersecting hills and troughs that are pliable and fluid. For a long time, I've wondered if the topographies of magnetohydrodynamics were similar in any way to the way watersheds function. If the plasma is collected and directed in a fashion similar to the way water will collect and direct to the lowest point and form rivers and streams. The three-dimensional waveforms caused by dichotron radiation might dictate which direction the plasma charge flows according to the topographies of these interacting matrix surfaces. Would these be plasma sheds? Just a thought. Paith, the soft birch, was the last addition to the alphabet. To me, the symbol looks like parallel charges, one being greater than the other, but it could just mean cathode. And let's not forget to say that the vertical spaces between the letters are called spas, space. It's this little bit that makes the Ogham Fews almost impossible to translate into binary codes for computers to read, because it's a space that isn't a space. Maybe it isn't a space, because it's a gap, a spark gap, perhaps. If you were going to illustrate a Whistler mode propagation, how would you draw it? Like this, maybe? If in you're thinking it looks a lot like Ifin, it's because it does. This is example 7.3 from Anthony Perrott, entitled Whistler Mode Propagation Through the Ionosphere. The description says, waves cannot be heard directly, but are converted into audible sound waves of the same frequency by an audio amplifier. They are propagated from one hemisphere to the other in the ionosphere and follow the Earth's dipole magnetic field lines. In propagation through the ionosphere, the group velocity is proportional to the square root of the frequency, so that its received signal is a descending tone lasting a few seconds. Maybe you would draw a schematic of Whistler mode propagation like the center line here. And it also makes me wonder if the square version of Fion's window might be the representation of the square root of the frequency being proportional to the group velocity passing through the ionosphere. Curiouser and curiouser. Maybe you would draw them like this. This is ray tracing the magnetosphere. Whistler waves, ADM Walker. In figure 4, characteristics of the Whistler mode. A is the refractive index. B is the set of wave fronts of the shape of the ray surface representing Whistler waves originating continuously from a point source. C is the group velocity surface. And D is a set of wave fronts following a signal representing the signals and originating from a point source that is abruptly switched on. This is a detail from the Book of Ballymote. It even kind of looks like a descending tone. How about a twisted poloidal field? Would you draw it like this? If I was into simplicity, I might draw it like this. And if I was really into simplicity, I might repurpose this diagram. Here's another one. How about a cross-section of a Birkeland current? Would you draw it like this, maybe? Birkeland currents are currents that run along Earth's magnetic field lines and connect the high-latitude ionosphere with Earth's magnetosphere. They can also be found as high-energy field-aligned currents out in space. They form twisted filamentary structures layered with counter-rotating currents that are often referred to as rope-like. In 1903, when Christian Birkeland discovered these currents, they were given his name. Today, the bright ones that run perpendicular to the geomagnetic field lines are sometimes called auroral jets. Maybe, if the whole of Fionn's window represents the trunk of the Birkeland current, one strand of a plasma channel could be the trunk of the Acme, or family, dare I say, tree, and that the Ogham Fews climb. Could the tree runes be representational of the tree-like branching that occurs in Lichtenberg figures? Are the tree associations themselves clues as to which kind of plasma branches implied by each of the Fews? For that, we're going to have to look at the only sources of electricity we knew the ancients had. Lightning and auroras. Maybe the ancients knew more about electromagnetic frequencies than we realize. Remember this from just a second ago? This would be a good place to repurpose this. Could these images be translated into different concepts? And the Book of Ballymote has an interesting progression for the placement of these diagrams as well.
What's the matter, David? I'm taking a shortcut before.
Where's the kaboom? There was supposed to be an earth-shattering kaboom. The Illudium PU-36 explosive space modulator. That creature has stolen the space modulator.
I wasn't sure if we could find those parts we were missing, so I went to the store to see if they had more. According to TowerOptical.com, an achromatic lens is a lens that transmits light without separating it. They say, we can combine multiple order wave plates made from two different birefringent materials to achieve achromatic compensation across a broad spectral range. I mean, if we're going to go to all this trouble, we might want to now direct our light beam without changing its physical makeup. A clear crystal quartz is ideal for this.
Dilithium chambers at maximum, Captain.
Magnesium fluoride and sapphires will also work. They're what's known as retarders. Quartz is the best option for this because it has a high damage threshold. A low beam deviation, the best transmitted wavefront in a small package, can be configured in multiple ways, are completely natural, and aren't too hard to come by. Though, they have a limited field of view, so you're probably going to need good aim. What were we aiming at again?
What is it you want, Barry? What do you want? You want the moon? Just say the word and I'll throw a lasso around it and pull it down.
If anybody has black parts, I need them, okay? I only work in black. And sometimes very, very dark gray.
Hey, where did you find this?
It walks under my seat.
Are they heavy?
Yeah.
Then they're expensive. Put them back.
Oh, wow.
That was a great, inspiring legend that you made up.
I suppose you think that was terribly clever. If you're referring to the incident with the dragon, I was barely involved.
I knew it. I knew you were bluffing. I knew he was bluffing.
I feel safer already.
Numbers held a dominant and impactful role in the ancient world. They were used for more than just numerical counting. Numbers still hold a symbolic meaning that transcends mere digits. They are often indicators of a specific energy or personality that is used as a descriptive association to better inform the reader or interpreter of a context. Numbers employ an extraordinary value in very simple forms. Many of the numbers held in high regard by the ancient peoples of Ireland can still be found being observed in these energetic terms by modern practitioners of ancient art of Druidry. The patterns identified by the ancients seem to be summed up nicely in the simplest of symbolic forms that can transmit the optimal amount of information. It's remarkably practical and astoundingly efficient. By observing the phenomena of the natural world, the ancients were able to hone in on certain patterns that repeat. Assigning a simple form to the entire collective of applicable components allowed for the shearing down of needed symbols and thus simplified the explanation to the reader, and saved on writing. They have three elemental tables, the druids, that assign various attributes to each element. The number of elements grows with each table, as do some of the attributes given to each of the said elements. The number four has many meanings, but is most predominantly associated with the seasons and the cardinal directions. The number five and its importance in the Ogham is a quandary that has perplexed many researchers. I must confess, I too have been puzzled by the role of the number five in the ancient understanding worldwide for some time. I'm mystified by it. Why five of things? Why is this number significant in practical sense? Elementary, my dear watchers. Elementary particles, that is. When we talk about an order of magnitude, it isn't like adding fries onto our meal. May I have an order of magnitude with that, please?
On the side.
Orders of magnitude determine the size classification of each class in a system. These orders are generally greater or smaller by a number of times, most commonly 10, and expressed in exponentials. The spatial, temporal, and other behavioral parameters of plasma may be scaled in just such a manner. It's really simplitude. Similitude. That's what I meant to say. If a model and a real application share geometric, kinetic, and dynamic similarity, the concept of similitude can be applied to test engineering models. These similarity laws can also be applied to plasma. In 1893, Hans Alfvén, the renowned Swedish plasma physicist who won a Nobel Prize for his description of a class of magnetohydrodynamic waves that surround the Earth and we now know as Alfvén waves, proposed a formula for the scaling of plasma that can allow the results of plasma experiments in the laboratory to be scaled up to the magnetospheric and then cosmic scale by making jumps by a factor of 10th and 9th power. Jump to present day, Belarusian physicist Eugene Bagashov has added a couple more layers to the micro end of this leap by jumping backwards into the realms of atoms and quarks. It stands to reason that this quintuple jump results in a recirculation of the particles involved. When the plasma reaches the distance of the cosmic scale, the particles that have made their way through each jump step into the macro scale and have ultimately returned to their tiniest selves in the huge expanse of outer space, only to be collected again into some new condensed form. Maybe, probably, eventually. But the plasma will behave the same, no matter the scale. Could these five leaps in scale be applicable to the five rings of Fion's window and the key to understanding the five levels of each of the Acme? What are we really looking at here? Where else do we see fives? There are five layers in the corona glow images from there are five sets of rungs in some of Perrott's ladder pipettes before the ends start to curl. Leader breakdowns occur at 1/5 the speed of light. Five layers in Scott's Brooklyn current models. Irish poetry is written in a meter of five, iambic pentameter. There are five members of the Indentations and the Jackson Five. Okay, now I'm getting carried away, but I do love Motown. Oh, and there's five spheres in the mound at Newgrange, if you include the stone circle outside, which I do, and five sections to the Cairns Passage. And I keep also wanting to mention the fifth harmonic here too, so I will. And I could go on, but that's a fair amount of five.
I, using musical theory, have created order out of chaos.
This is one type of scaling. Dr. Michael Claridge of the Sapphire Project has identified another type of logarithmic scaling that is based on the distance of orbital spacing of planets. Here is a slide from Dr. Claridge's Observing the Frontier presentation that he explains as, quote, showing the logarithmic scaling of planet orbit spacings of 15 different planetary systems, solar systems. He says, we seem to not have a very good term for these things in English, star systems, solar systems, planetary systems. It's true, we don't. What term may better describe the whole of the system? Current systems? Currents in space are difficult to see because they travel in opposite directions. They become a coaxial structure. This coaxial structure controls the broadcasting of information. The more energy that is flowing, the more layers of counter-rotating currents. Magnetic charge pulls the current into a line. For Earth, these currents travel along the line of sunset and sunrise. In the solar system, the energy breaks up into little bunches. Earth is one of those bunches. Claridge says, "My analysis has not yet connected the electric current model of star formation to planet spacing. So far, my analysis only connects the protoplanetary disks to an electric current model for planetary system formation. The protoplanetary systems do not show logarithmic scaling. They show more of a linear scaling with roughly equal spacing between each ring. The logarithmic scaling does not have equal spacing between each ring." Thank you, Dr. Claridge. "Each planetary coil shared resonances with all the other coils, implying a coherent system. This is a new and improved way of understanding the formation and behavior of solar systems. Does this discovery mean that the geometries of planetary bodies can be presumed without having to consider the size, mass, and compositions of the bodies themselves? Can this logarithmic scaling be applied to other forms of plasma systems? Are these logarithms applicable to ancient astronomical calculations? Is this the same technique used to map the cosmos in antiquity?"
Oh! Great Odin's raven!
This looks extraordinarily bad.
Any idea is a good idea, except the not happy ones. Those you push down deep inside where you'll never, ever, ever,
ever
find them.
In a recently published paper by Mark Turler of the Swiss Academy of Sciences titled "Calendrical Interpretations of Spirals in Irish Megalithic Art," passageways in Neolithic mounds in Newgrange and Noth were found to align with cyclical celestial events. 5 possible solar and lunar cycle observations were identified, and more are suggested. 1. The ratio between 12 and 13 lunar cycles per solar cycle. 2. The increase, respectively decrease, of daylight in the winter, spring, and summer autumn semesters. 3. The association of widening, respective shrinking, of the arc daily traced in the sky by the sun. 4. The Y dominant path in the sky of the first quarter moon in the winter spring season and of the third quarter moon in the summer autumn semester. And 5. The gnomon pattern with the equinoctial flip from light to spring summer semester to dark autumn winter season. He says, "The more complex spirals appear to include more celestial manifestations. It suggests that the intellectual elite of this Neolithic settlement linked the astronomical cycles to the passage of seasons, followed them over the years, and represented them with increasingly elaborate symbols. This process, from observations to abstract models, preserved in engraved signs, can be considered as truly scientific approach." Thank you, Mr. Turler. It's true. The spirals seem to fit into the patterns of the celestial body movements perfectly. Why would it be so important to track these movements and record them with such painstaking detail? What if these patterns are the same patterns that can be found throughout all scales of plasma dynamics? It would stand to reason that the spirals might be patterns for much larger and much smaller scale occurrences. What more could they be? And what were they doing with them? The current sheet in the solar system that marks the change of polarity within the sun's magnetic field is called the heliospheric current sheet. It sits at the sun's equator and stretches far out beyond the observable planets like a twirling ballerina skirt. In the 1950s, an astrophysicist at the University of Chicago realized that the sun was blowing charged particles out into space that were capable of causing motion in the tails of comets. Eugene Parker had discovered the solar wind. In 1958, Parker published a paper accurately defining a complex plasma flow system and incorporated the magnetic fields and high-energy particles into a spiral shape that emits from our spinning sun. We call this the Parker Spiral. Maybe the ancients knew about the spiral long before Parker. I would venture to say that what has been identified here is what modern druids refer to as the three rays of light. Many surviving ancient belief structures incorporate a version of life force energy. Eastern philosophies refer to it as chi or prana. The druids call this force Nufra, kind of like the force. Nufra is very important. They say it is the energy from the source or Ewan. What exactly is this life force energy? Is it something that can be detected, quantified, measured? Could it be something we're already measuring? Could it be electromagnetic? Could it be plasma? What if the spirals are all this and more? The three rays of light are talking about three ways of receiving energy. This is important because the main form of life energy, Nufra, is incorporated into the whole of their philosophy. The three rays of light are invoking and evoking this energy, and the two together make the triband. The description of this function is reminiscent of the descriptions of electron avalanching. It's just one of the functions that can be described by this relative notion. On the solar quarters, when the sun shines from the eastern horizon, shadows cast on the ground, southwest at midwinter, northwest at midsummer, and due east on spring and fall. As previously stated, the druids have elemental tables for 3, 4, and 5 elements. For the three-part path, there are the Nufra, the source of life and consciousness, the Guyar, the source of change, motion, growth, and Kalas, the source of form, differentiation, manifestation, and stability. These convert to modern understanding respectively as energy, liquid, and solid. Each also has a moon phase and a season associated with it. Nufra is the full moon in summer, Guyar is the half moon spring-fall, and Kalas is the new moon in the winter. These are the cycles known to be affiliated with the three rays of light. I will touch on this converging of ideas to say a few quick words about the assignment of the lunar cycles to the seasons. The druids are correct to associate the new moon with the winter and the full moon to the summer. It does seem counterintuitive when visualizing the path of the body and the duration of the time it takes for it to transit that path, but the path isn't the reason for the association. It's the energetic function of the body and its effect on the planet. During the new moon cycle, no solar energy is reflected via the moon. The main types of growth happening within plant structures are underground. We focus on planting seeds and the patience of sleeping processes that happen in the dark, like root growth and healing. The winter is dark. The whole of the winter is seen as the dark growth phase. During the full moon, when the solar light is reflected back from the full face of the moon, we focus on above ground happenings within plant structures, including pruning of upward shoots. Harvesting is best at the peak of the full moon when the water within the plant has pulled the maximum amount of essence, flavonoid, terpenes, nutrients, etc. So the full moon is associated with summer since it's the light growth phase of the year. These specific connotations with the moon cycle are profound for other reasons as well. During the new moon phase, the moon is always in the upstream portion of Earth's magnetosphere, facing the sun. During the full moon, the moon is in the downstream portion of the tail of the magnetosphere. At the first quarter, it is to the dusk side of Earth. At last quarter, the moon faces the dawn side of the magnetosphere. Hold that thought. There are three types of Nufra. These types of energy are what we know today as EMF currents. They have druidic designations to some of the currents that we call today space weather. There is the Aud from the sun, the solar currents. They are the strongest at dawn and noon, and they always move downward. This is druidry, not science, and it's so compelling. Then there is the Aub from the earth, the telluric currents. They follow complex cycles, are shaped by the lunar cycle, planetary seasonal changes, and the subtle interplay between the groundwater with stone and soil. These currents move upward. Then, lastly, there's the hour from the moon. The Ad and the Alb combine to make the hour. It mediates between the Ad and the Ab. It depends on the two primary currents, the solar and the telluric, and is created out of the fusion of the two. The Ab is represented by an upward-facing triangle, the symbol for the fire since it is the currents from the fire of the earth. The Ad is represented by a circle for the round disk of the sun. And the Aur is represented by the crescent moon shape, which is used to depict the moon symbolically. When we stack them, they represent the Grail. John Michael Greer says in the Druidry Handbook, "From their interplay unfolds the organic pattern of the Druid cosmos." Some visionary scholars describe a time in antiquity when the power of the three currents was mastered by the sages. As Greer puts it, an age long gone when the telluric current flowed through the lines traced on the landscape to hills, then leaped down through prepared channels to stone circles nearby where it fused with the solar current and sent the sacred fire of the lunar current surging outward. Even Greer believes he's speaking in a metaphor for looking at our past, present, and future selves. And that might be partially true. Well, what else is true? What if we take this literally? I'm going to take the more sage advice and say, if it looks like a duck and it quacks like a duck, it's probably a duck. And I'm going to say that it's not a metaphor. And though I'm not a duck at this point, you might think I'm a quack, but let's not get our feathers ruffled quite yet. What if the spiral patterns like the Ogham had more than five meanings? Are the rules of scaling applicable to the spirals? I mean, the ancients were extremely efficient at recording pretty much everything. It takes a lot of muscle to move these cumbersome stones. Have you ever tried to carve stone? I have. It's difficult with modern carving tools. I'm sure the people making these creations were trying to maximize the message while minimizing the work. So many things can and should be interpreted from the marks they left. What is it that they were looking at? How should we be reading this? There's so much more to this. What happens next? What are they really spelling? How exactly could all of the proposed happen? What does history say? How do we balance the three rays of light? What were they doing with it? How do we translate these messages? What combination of frequencies does what? What do the combinations unlock? What else do we need to make it real? Could we do it again? Should we want to? Who else was in on this?
Major Dallas, you've been selected for a mission of the utmost importance.
What mission?
Save the world.
How's that for a slice of fried gold?
You believe everything you hear on TV?
What was that?
It's the finale.
Wasn't that just magnificent? I was worried it was getting a little dodgy in the middle part, but then that finale. Wow!
Bye-bye, boys!
Have fun storming the castle!
Think it'll work?
It would take a miracle.
Bye-bye!